Welcome back to Fox Hill's Black Report, your daily source of Black news, Black views, and Black opinions. Today is Thursday, April 28th, and I'm Mimi Brown.
I'm Romeo.
I'm Demi Lobo. And on today's report, could Brittney Griner be coming home soon? This after the Biden administration negotiated the release of an American serviceman locked up in Russia. Meanwhile, a new report says Minneapolis police routinely engage in racial discrimination and they fail to hold their officers accountable for misconduct. But what are the next steps for the DOJ? Then a Missouri man who was sentenced to life in prison for a murder he did not commit is a free man today. We have the story.
Plus, new details have been released concerning the ASAP Rocky shooting incident. What was found after a search was conducted at his home? And should Black people attend the Country Music Awards? Monica, R&B singer Monica, weighs in on the debate. We have all of that and so much more. This is our voice and our truth. So let's get it.
Well, as news broke that the Biden administration negotiated the release of an American serviceman locked up in Russia, questions about could Brittney Griner be next also began to surface. White House officials say they have not forgotten about the WNBA star and are working to bring her home. Trevor Reed was a former Marine released from a Russian prison yesterday. He's been in a Russian prison since 2019 after he was convicted of attacking cops. Now, one driving factor in Reed's release was that he was in poor health. He was traded for a Russian pilot sentenced to prison in the United States for cocaine trafficking. Meanwhile, Griner has been detained in Russia since February. She was arrested after authorities claimed she was carrying a vape pen with cannabis oil in her luggage. Her detention has been extended till May 19th. She could face as much as 10 years in prison. And the State Department says Griner, though, she is a top priority. I was really encouraged by this because I feel like the good news is that the channels of communication between the U.S. and Russian officials are still open. I, like many other people, probably assumed because of the war and how the U.S. has been supporting Ukraine that those channels were now closed. So for me, this gives me a little hope. This gives me, you know, at least I know that they're talking, and that means that she could perhaps be, you know, working on a back deal that we just don't know about.
You know, we haven't heard a lot about Brittney Griner in recent days, and we know that there's a trial coming up in May. And I'm also happy to hear about this, Mimi, because, you know, I've been really, really nervous about Brittney Griner and her return, because I feel like as a Black queer woman, there's so many old tweets and old messages, old statements that she said that I feel like they are dying to use against her. And so I'm really wondering what's going to happen during the trial. But again, I just really feel like she's gonna come home soon, but also I have that fear at the same time.
Yeah, you know, once again, this man being released, which we are glad he is released, it gives us hope. So now, like you said, lines of communication is open during a time of war, but how is she being treated? We don't really know for sure. They're saying she's okay, but we don't know that until we actually see her again. And that also brings up the subject where, Mimi, you brought this up a while back, excuse me, you know, should athletes even go abroad moving forward? Because we don't want to be in this situation once again down the road. And will we have to make another switch in order for her to come home? That's the question, too.
No, you're right, Romeo. I mean, just her being in jail there highlights that gender pay gap, right? Mm-hmm. I think the WNBA, they cap their players at about $230,000 a year. So they do go overseas to supplement that income, you know? And so I think that's something for us here in America to address, you know, why we are paying our women much, much less than we are paying our men, you know? And yesterday when this story broke, her name began to trend online. And, you know, I was happy to see that. But I also, you know, I still think that there's a fine line to walk, because if we make her such a big deal, and I think Lisa Leslie talked about this in a podcast a couple weeks ago, you know, the WNBA has been told to kind of lay low and don't do rallies and campaigns and things that will bring more attention to her, because Russian officials will then ultimately use her as a pawn and make her release harder for her to come home.
Agreed. You know, the difference, though, that the person that was released is he wasn't a Black person. So, you know, we're thinking, I'm wondering if that's, it gives us a glimmer of hope, but also it's just very different for Black people in America. So I'm just wondering how that,
Yeah, you're right. It's very different for Black people in America. And I think that Press Secretary Jen Psaki, she came out and said that one of the conditions for his release was that he's in very poor health. His parents say that he had, he contracted tuberculosis when he was there and they weren't treating him, right? So
Well, it also feels like your health has to decline a lot in order for
it's
you to.
It's a lot of different.
We're hoping that's not the case for her. But we'll see.
We sure will. While gas prices and inflation have hurt President Biden's approval ratings among most Americans, he still gets high marks from black people. A new Quinnipiac poll, it says that 69% of African Americans, they approve of the job that he's doing. That's much higher than the 40% approval ratings he's getting from the overall U.S. population. Now, political analysts say that Biden's doing better with black people because his priorities are in line with the black community. Although high inflation, it hurt African Americans disproportionately. Other issues like criminal justice and voting rights, health care and housing are important to our communities. Biden got 87% of the black vote in 2020.
The Minneapolis Police Department has engaged in a pattern of racial discrimination that goes back at least a decade. We're talking, that's according to the Minnesota's Department of Human Rights. The report was launched after the murder of George Floyd, who was killed by a Minneapolis cop. It found Minneapolis police routinely engage in racial discrimination and failed to hold their officers accountable for misconduct. Their investigation also found that Minneapolis officers have used covert social media accounts unrelated to any cases in order to monitor black people and other groups. The report says that the department maintained a culture where racist and disrespectful language was tolerated. No individuals were singled out, but the DOJ is also looking into the Minneapolis department as well. Both investigations could result in consent decrees like Seattle has. So we talk about what's going on, and I think there's really no secret. For years, for decades, if you go across the country, you're probably going to find there's a lot of wrongdoing when it comes to police officers and people of color, things that have happened. I know people where things have happened to them, and they've been too scared to come forward, right? So when we see things like this happen with George Floyd that happens in front of the world to see, we want to know what's going on, not just in that city, but across the country. And they've investigated, I think, over 430,000 pages, right, of the last 10 years of good and bad that's happened in that city. But the real question is, how do they fix it?
Well, you know, this is definitely a step in the right direction, Romeo. But with this report, what I really like is that they're going to reach out to community members to get their ideas on what should happen next. Because a lot of times with new data that comes forward, it's kind of their own data that they did. You know, there was an outside investigation, but there wasn't a lot of detailed input done in the community. And so Minnesota specifically, has had a large issue with police brutality. And so I'm really happy that the community members are going to get a chance to weigh in on what should happen next in the city.
No, you're absolutely right, Demi. And I, you know, for me, though, I feel like it's kind of unfortunate that we have to have a report to validate what black people have been saying for years. You know, it's almost like if it wasn't caught on video, then it didn't happen. So a lot of times now we hear that, you know, white people are waking up to what we've been saying because they get to see it. It's almost like if we say it, it didn't happen. Mm-hmm. Where's the proof? Mm-hmm. And so for me, this report is great. But, you know, the city of Minneapolis has paid out $80 million since 2003. Mm-hmm. So that right there tells you that there has been a problem with police brutality, and what happened with George Floyd just brought it to the top. So, you know, I while I'm grateful for this, I just think that if you should believe what we're saying when we say it.
You definitely should. And I think the question is, what do we do with the police department, with those officers, when we notice some of them sometimes are not even kicked off the force, or if they are, leave of absence and put to the side, they still get paid if they're not working, right? Yeah. What's it called when you're on leave? Something like that? I forgot the terminology for it. Well, we'll say paid leave.
Paid leave.
Okay, that's what we'll say.
Universal everywhere.
That definitely works. And that's the problem, because then we're saying, well, how do we see what's going on, yet you continue to keep these men in uniform and women in uniform? How do we feel safe moving forward?
Yeah, you know, and Mimi, I'm actually glad that you brought up the amount of money that the department has spent on black lives that you've just killed. And so it really lets you know, what is the price tag that a black person's life is? It could be $2 million, it could be $5 million. And that also, I don't want to say that I want money to stop coming into black families. I don't want that to happen. But I really don't want the price tag to be the only consequence that the police department has to pay going forward. Because they just don't mind shelling out $2 million, $3 million here for every family.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Is it really a consequence? Because they almost rather give the money than stop brutalizing us, right?
And I believe it's taxpayers' money.
Exactly.
Great point.
All right. The Department of Justice is launching an online portal to give police departments around the nation resources that can be devoted to promoting good police practices. The National Law Enforcement Knowledge Lab will be a one-stop shop for police agencies that will provide training, information, and guidance on how they can do better. The move comes years after the mass demonstrations calling for police reform after the death of George Floyd. The portal will provide specifics on and demand consultations for police departments that could benefit from more services and resources as they try to better improve policing tactics.
The front runner in the Democratic Party race for the U.S. Senate may have to work harder to get the black vote in Pennsylvania after the recent debate. That's right, in that state, because last week's debate between Lieutenant Governor John Fetterman, Congressman Connor Lamb, and State Representative Malcolm Kenyatta reminded black voters of the incident where Fetterman pulled a shotgun on a black jogger. Kenyatta demanded Fetterman to apologize for the incident. Fetterman supporters are worried black voters will think twice about voting for him. Back in 2013, Fetterman chased a man down who was just jogging in the neighborhood. Fetterman, who was a mayor at the time, says he heard gunshots and thought the jogger was running from the scene. He said he was not racially profiling the man.
Mm-hmm. And police in suburban Atlantic County are investigating several Ku Klux Klan flyers discovered in several parts of the area. DeKalb County police say the flyers don't have direct threats that would prompt a criminal investigation. Now, the mayor of Tucker, Georgia, Frank Allman, he says that the flyers are repugnant and small-minded. The story is similar to incidents of Klan flyers that have blanketed the Houston area. A group called the Aryan Freedom Network claimed responsible for leaving the flyers in Houston neighborhoods.
The police shooting of Patrick Loyola, the black man killed in Michigan, has been a rude awakening for many African immigrants in Grand Rapids. Loyola, like others, escaped war-torn or impoverished areas in the African continent with hopes of freedom and safety in the United States. But many are coming to terms with the realization that despite having come to this country for the American dream, they have in fact inherited the black American reality, which is riddled with a complex racial history that many Africans are still struggling to understand. They say they are often treated with disrespect by police officers who pull them over while driving. Now, Loyola was a refugee from the Democratic Republic of Congo. He and his family came here to escape the civil wars and violence that plagued that country. Earlier this week, Grand Rapids police publicly identified Christopher Scher as the officer who shot and killed him. Now, according to the department, he's on administrative leave and has been stripped of all of his policing duties pending the investigation.
Civil rights attorney Ben Crump is joining a class action lawsuit against Wells Fargo. The bank has been accused of discriminating against African Americans when it comes to mortgage lending. Fortune magazine says the bank approves only 47% of applications from black borrowers compared to 72% for white applicants.
With the discriminatory practices of Wells Fargo Bank, it leads to the unjust killing of black Americans' opportunity.
Wells Fargo's acceptance rate for African Americans is far behind other banks. JP Morgan Chase, the largest bank in the United States, approved 81% of black loan applicants.
Activists in Mississippi are called for an end to Confederate Memorial Day in the state. Now, Monday was Confederate Memorial Day in the state. This year's celebration comes 2 weeks after Governor Tate, he retired the state flag that had a Confederate emblem. Protesters say the state should stop celebrating the day. The last Monday in April is recognized as Confederate Memorial Day, weeks before the nationally celebrated Memorial Day, a day honoring men and women who have fought in American wars.
A 17-year-old boy might be alive today if police had not lied on an intake form at a hospital. That's what the family of Cedric Lofton says. Lofton is the Wichita, Kansas teen who was held down by juvenile intake staff members for more than 30 minutes last year. Lofton's family says the officer who changed the answers on the form may have prevented him from getting the medical care he needed. Authorities say Lofton had been behaving badly when he arrived. As a result, the officer indicated on the form that Lofton showed signs of intoxication. Now, according to family members, Lofton was having a mental health breakdown. He had been in and out of foster care and had been dealing with the death of his grandmother at the time of his arrest. A secondary medical examination of Lofton says he died from congestive heart failure after a physical struggle where he was restrained in the prone position. Authorities have declined to file charges against staff members who restrained Lofton, citing the state's stand your ground law and claiming staff members had been defending themselves. While Lofton's death, it's renewing criticism of the stand your ground laws and highlighting laws that are supposed to protect those 17 and under. This case is more than sad. you know, locked in. He was a foster child, mm-hmm. and his foster father called 911 a couple of times because he was having hallucinations. He was saying that in school, the security guards were they were special agents, and when he went home, he would go in and close his door and say that he was staying inside because that was the only place in the house that wasn't bugged. So the foster father, he called the police a couple times. When they finally came out and got him, they took him to jail. Once again, you know, we always talk about mental health resources, mm-hmm. and what, you know, what that looks like when we reimagine safety for our Black people, basically. And so when he was arrested, I don't know what happened in between. It gets kind of murky for mm-hmm. me, but the fact remains, I don't understand how you can claim stand your ground when he was, in essence, in jail. He was a prisoner. So, you know, if someone is restraining you for 30 minutes and you're fighting back, you're struggling to breathe, how do you claim self-defense mm-hmm. when he is literally at your mercy? Yeah. I don't understand that.
You know, well, this definitely is, there are a lot of details that are missing from this. Yeah. Mimi, I agree with you. But one thing that I can add to the story is, so initially with Cedric Lofton, so he, again, we said that he showed signs of mental illness. The police officer initially said on the intake form that he showed signs of mental illness, he should go to a hospital. So then he changed his story. He talked to some other police officers, some other officers. He changed his answer, and so then Cedric Lofton stayed in police custody, and so he died just hours later. And so one person put on Twitter that I thought was very powerful, and she said that journalists need to start changing our language, and that's included that it says he died in police custody versus the police officer killed him, and that is literally what happened. And so even us, we're guilty of saying he died in police custody, which is the politically correct term to say. Yeah. But no, these police officers killed this man.
You know, and we have so many stories that we've shared about situations like this where we talk about, hey, you know what? Here's people that have been lost at the hands of whether it's police officers or those in juvenile detention. Like, either way, how do we fix it? How do we set it up where there's another number you can call to make things right? So that's what we have to look forward to, because we report this where family members so many times make that phone call seeking help and it ends up like this. Mm-hmm. And it's just not fair.
Absolutely.
All right, the L.A. County Sheriff's Department tried to cover up an incident in which a deputy kneels on the head of a handcuffed inmate for 3 minutes. That's according to a Los Angeles Times newspaper investigation. The Times said it reviewed internal records from department officials that claim Sheriff Alex Villanueva lied about what he knew about the incident. The inmate Enzo Escalante has sued the department for the assault. Meanwhile, Sheriff Villanueva says his department is targeting the Times reporter in a criminal leak investigation. Hmm.
And a mother in suburban St. Louis is angry after her 9-year-old son's school failed to do anything after the boy cut his finger very severe in class, and it had to be amputated. A lawyer for DJ Williams' mother says the child was running in a classroom when he fell and severed part of his middle finger on a metal filing cabinet. So instead of calling for an ambulance, the boy was sent to the school's nurse. Attorneys say when DJ's grandfather came to pick him up from school, he noticed the damaged finger and rushed him to the hospital immediately. Doctors say DJ's entire hand may have been amputated. Now, school officials say they are looking into the incident more. Days later, the child's teacher called DJ's mother saying that she has the severed portion of the finger. The family is hoping that this can be reattached to his hand.
And a Missouri man who was sentenced to life in prison for murder he did not commit is a free man today. 52-year-old Keith Carnes spent 18 years behind bars for the 2003 killing of a 24-year-old Larry White. Lawyers for Carnes say there was never any physical evidence connecting him to the shooting in what police have called a drug deal gone bad. The Missouri Supreme Court set aside his conviction earlier this week after two eyewitnesses recanted. Now, Jackson County, Missouri prosecutors say they have no plans to retry him.